too broke for rental. This cost of living is driving me mental. Wanna move out, get away from parentals. Don't forget to invest, I'm feeling stressed. Cause what if I can't retire? I'm probably just expire. Can someone give me an answer? And keep it simple, keep it simple.
Hi everybody, my name is Duan and I'm a content lead for The Simple Sum. So instead of Soap and Pris, I'll be taking over from time to time to do something called 101 with Duan. I didn't come up with that name. So on this series, I'll be delving just a little deeper into personal finance topics. And I won't be doing it alone. I'll be roping in experts around certain fields from investing to insurance to help us all better understand personal finance topics. So, I'll be talking to Sheng Shi from Endowus, the robo-advisor. We'll be talking about passive investing and robo-advisors in general. Both are pretty good ways for beginners to start their investment journey. We also got some questions around these topics from our IG followers last week. So, if you ask questions, stay tuned, and we might have covered it. So, hi Sheng Shi, thanks for coming on. Maybe you want to do an introduction of yourself first?
Yeah, sure. I'm Sheng Shi, the personal finance lead of Endowus. So the main part of my work is around content marketing. So basically, I help people understand how Endowus can fit into their daily life and their financial goals.
So yeah, what do you do with Endowus on a day-to-day basis? And if you could, maybe explain a little bit more of what's Endowus.
Yeah, sure. So most of my work actually revolves around engaging the community. So I am actually very active on the Seedly forums. And I also write a lot of content around passive investing, managing your money, think of budget, so that people understand how to even get started on looking at investments. So Endowus is a digital wealth platform. So what we do is that we offer investment and cash management solution for various sources of wealth, right? So not just investing your cash, but also your CPF and SRS as well. So what we give to investors is a really globally diversified portfolio that is aligned to their risk profile.
Right. So y'all help investors invest in a nutshell. Am I right to say that passive investing is a methodology that robo's advisors like Endowus employs for helping people to invest?
I think if we were to ask it that way, it's important for us to understand what passive investing really means. Generally, when people talk about passive investing, they talk about buying into passive funds, buying into an ETF, which could be the S&P 500, or maybe some globally diversified funds like IWDA or some Vanguard funds that track the global stock index. So that's one way of passively investing. There's also other ways to look at passive investing. So not just the type of funds that we buy, but also how we do our asset allocation. So we could be investing all of our money into equities in 1 month, but then we suddenly switch everything to bonds, for example, right? So that form of switching across different type of funds, across different type of allocation is actually not really passive investing, right? To really passively invest in a passive asset allocation, it means that you just stick to the same thing every month, buying into a fixed allocation of stocks, bonds, or even maybe even commodities.
So in a sense, you're saying that, you know, there's a passive investing layer, which is an instrument that is passive. It's a very broad fund of, let's say, bonds, stocks. That's one layer, and sticking to it and investing into it at a regular period. And that's another level of passive investing. I think that's a good introduction to passive investing. So now let's talk about actually you and me.
Okay,
you
know, sure.
So to disclaim to our audience, Sheng Shi and I are both passive investors. So there might be a little bit of bias to this topic, you know, but we will both try to be objective and also share the pros and cons to this approach. But, you know, on that note, could you talk about your journey to becoming a passive investor? Because I know that that's not how you started out, isn't that right?
Yeah, that's right. So I guess even before we start investing, we need to accumulate money for us to have that money to invest, right? So when I first started off, I'm actually a very frugal person, right? My parents teach me to be very frugal, and I managed to save up quite a bit of money doing part-time work through my NS so that I have some money to invest when I'm in university. So I studied business in NUS, particularly in finance. So I was quite curious to understand how, you know, the discounted cash flow models, the concepts taught in finance, finance, how does it translate into stock picking, equities investing? So I started off back then investing in things that are very, very hot. So back then, REITs are really hot, and I still believe they are quite of a great interest to Singaporean investors because of the dividend yield, right? So I invested in REITs back then. But I find that the investment process was not really very, it didn't feel very scientific and very objective because I find that, you know, sometimes when I do a lot of research, the kind of returns that I get doesn't reciprocate for the work that I put in. The other way can work as well, right? Sometimes I don't put in so much work, I just read some blogs, then I make a speculative bet, right? And somehow it managed to work out. So at some point of time, I realized that I feel that I'm gambling more than investing, and I really don't like that feeling because it makes me feel like I'm putting hard saved money into something that there's no level of certainty to. So I think back then I become more inclined towards learning about passive investing, which is really to focusing on things that are within my control, which are things like, you know, the cost of the funds, investing consistently, making sure that I do my financial planning properly so that I will never need to liquidate my funds for my own short term needs, so that, you know, I'm able to let money grow over a long period of time and let my money work for me instead of, you know, working hard and worrying about my money when it comes to stock picking.
For me, I'm slightly different. To share my story, I actually started off straight passive because then I was looking into ways to start investing, and the way I came across first was passive investing. But I have to say, try to dabble into active investing, because of course the promise of higher returns is always compelling. No, but I wanted to do it the right way. I went to study up Warren Buffett discounted cash flow models, as you said, to really go through 10 years of financial reports of the company. And, you know, I still remember it was Raffles Medical, the first one I tried, and even then I realized that was half of the equation. That was only like the last 10 years of growth, and you still need to, it doesn't guarantee that the stock would keep growing, and that still dissuaded me. And I have the same word that you use, I really resonate with it, conviction. And so far, passive investing I found was the only one based on historical data that can give a higher level of conviction. And that's my story.
Interesting. I think the word conviction will probably be used a lot around this podcast today. But I totally agree with you around the word conviction, because end of the day, I think we have to be very cognizant to the fact that there's a lot of news around the markets, right? If you are a passive investor, there can be big macroeconomic things that are happening on a day-to-day basis that will affect how the index move, how the general stocks go up or down. And a lot of it is not within our control. And that's just for indexing. But for single companies, it becomes a lot more complicated. There is competition, there is a lot of new innovation, patent laws, and we don't necessarily understand the kind of industries that single companies operate in, right? And it's very difficult for us as students, as full-time employees, to keep track of this news. So because of the nature of my work, I actually talk a lot to financial bloggers, right? And some of them are super passionate around active investing, picking their own stocks, and some of them even set up their own fund where they are able to get investors to invest through them. So,
wow.
Yeah, it's extremely impressive. I think it's really impressive that you can be so passionate about it and so good at it that you are able to raise a fund for it. But I don't think that is necessarily something that we have the talent for to execute it well. And most importantly, the conviction to do it in a very consistent, long-term manner. Because even for myself, maybe even for Yuan Duan, it's difficult to hold on to our investment passively because of how the markets have moved.
You know, if we talk about active investing, you know, I'm never one to put it down, because definitely there are people who can get great returns. But I think, you know, we did an article earlier about SPIVA. It's just a measure of a report card per se of active fund managers, professionals, that find it very hard to beat the index consistently. You know, I think it's like 20% in America, the developed countries, that can outperform a passive methodology. And even then, none of them really do it very consistently. So, I not to say that you can't, I think we have actually, like, you know, there are bloggers in Singapore that, you know, I know, have done very well with active investing. These are people who, they're extremely passionate about it. They really, it's a second job.
Mm.
You know, and I really don't think that's for everybody.
Yeah, I just want to point out something about the Spiva survey. What really stands out is that for over a shorter period of time, there is a lot more fund managers who are able to outperform the market. But if you were to look at a longer period of time, it becomes less obvious that they are able to beat the market. So if you look at short-term trends, right, it's easy for people to say that they have done well in the stock, in the equities investing. So for example, your friend would have said, hey, I managed to buy Tesla at a low, and now I've made like 2 or 3 times because, you know, I read the news. I'm always in the understanding the market. I understand businesses. But right, it's really easy for us to say, make that kind of comments, right? But end of the day, how are we able to do it consistently or not? Do we have the time and resources to do it with conviction? I think that is a big question that we have to, I hope the listeners will consider and ask themselves before they make any decision.
You know, when you say passive, you have to talk about active because it's just, you know, like fire and ice to a certain extent. So, but I think, you know, we covered quite well the gist of it. I hope people do kind of get a sense of what passive indexing. But I think one thing we have not covered is regular amounts consistently a month.
I would say that investing regularly really depends on your own personal cash flow. So for us, people who have already started working, the kind of cash flow that we have is on a monthly basis, right? We get our salary, and the textbook way of managing our money is really to pay ourselves first. Right, we put in, maybe squirrel away $1,000 a month that we find that is enough for us to save for our financial goals, right? And the rest of the money could be used for expenses that we have budgeted for. So that $1,000 would be that amount of money that we invest on a regular basis, barring any big changes in our personal financial circumstances. So that is how I think about being able to passively squirrel away some money to invest, right? And that also kind of applies to the kind of bonus that we get, right? So for example, if we do well at work, we get 2 months worth of bonus. Then let's say we have $11,000 that month. So I would just invest the full $11,000. So that there's no accumulation of wealth, right? And I don't believe in the concept of, you know, keeping some money in as a war chest, right?
Right, I understand. So, you're not a dry powder guy.
I'm never a dry powder guy. I don't believe in buying in dips because the concept of buying things cheaper always sound very good. But end of the day, there are time periods where the market keeps going up and you're always still looking at that lower price that you want to go in at. So that is that is a very operational problem that someone who's trying to buy at dips will face when they invest.
Yeah, I mean, definitely I've looked at the literature. So like, you know, lump sum as soon as possible always wins up. Because if the idea of passive investing is that you are investing for extremely long term, I mean longer term. So the idea is that the economy grows, the stocks that you buy trend along with it in the long term, although there are short term ups and downs and volatility. So in a sense, the earlier you buy, the bigger the discount you always get. That's the belief, one of the fundamental underpinnings of passive investing. Am I right to say that?
Yeah, let me just illustrate it with another example, because I guess there's a lot of way we can sugarcoat our own behavior. And to some extent, I am also victim of my own sugarcoating, right? So I have, there are points of time where I say that, hey, market is a bit high, it's a maybe wait for things to stabilize, right? Then I keep a bit more cash, then maybe next month I buy twice the amount. But the fact of matter is that nobody knows whether the market is high now or low, and it's a slippery slope. Once you start to have this kind of thought, you accumulate one extra month of money, two extra month of money, you know, the next thing you know, maybe you have like $20,000 and or $10,000, and you feel very stressed investing that big sum of money.
I also agree, because for me, I personally invest passively on a monthly basis because I just want to keep that momentum and I just want to keep going. But unlike you, I tried to be smart during the March correction, the COVID crash. I as you exactly said, accumulated a sum of money and wanted to get smart with it. And started like checking my app every day. Oh, you know, my ETF did the price go down? And in the end, I did deploy that war chest, as you can say, into the market. But it was really very stressful.
Mm.
I think until the point that I got so stressed out that I'm like, I don't care. I'm just going to put it in already. I don't want to think about it. But I would say the only good thing that I did was that I had a plan, a smaller amount each month, and I kept that up throughout. And that was a consolation to me that my investment journey was still on track. So let's take some of the questions that were sent in. First is from someone called Audie. What things should we look out for when choosing a robo? Hidden costs, returns, I'm a noob. Thanks.
I guess a lot of people talk around what are the returns of the robo, which robo gives the best return, right? But even I would say, please don't look at investment returns, because the market is very volatile and it's actually quite possible that any robo advisor that you know you have seen done well because of maybe because of luck and maybe because of the additional risk that they are taking. Maybe the best way to look at it is which robo advisor fits your investment needs the best. Right, so I think definitely one, the very fact that you are looking at robo-advisors means that you want a convenient platform for you to invest. So that could be, convenience could be seen in many ways, like having a very convenient sign-up process, could be convenience in terms of the how many different services that the robo-advisors have in place, right? So for endowers especially, we allow you to invest your CPF, SRS and cash into both investment portfolios as well as cash management solutions. So convenience is definitely one thing, right? Another thing is whether that robo-advisor is able to invest based on the type of your own investment style or investment beliefs. So for endowers, we invest in a very passive manner. Some people may want to outsource active investing in some sense, right? And choose a robo-advisor that specifically invests in a more active manner. So what happens is that, you know, choosing a platform that speaks to you about your investment style, I think that's very important as well.
Yeah, if I could weigh in, I mean, I agree, especially with your last point, because you know, while robos on the surface I think can look similar, but I think that sometimes if you look a bit deeper, there are differences. And I think it's very important for anybody to read up and understand each robo's stance and whether it resonates with you. I mean, I know endowers, you all have actually a commitment to low cost, and also you all have a commitment to the passive strategy, which I know other robos, some certain robos have different portfolio styles that are not actually passive. So, but not to say that it's wrong or not, but I think it's very important, rather than you look at returns and like, oh, this one's better, but it's actually to read up each robo. Like, do you like that one invest? What is their philosophy? You know?
Yeah, maybe just to differentiate us slightly from the other robo advisors, I think the way we set our offerings is to really be a core part of your investment portfolio, right? So that means that a really broadly diversified investment strategy, right? Investing across all different countries, all different sectors, and doing it in a very consistent manner, so that you are able to harness, you know, human ingenuity, productivity growth, the growth of capitalism over a long period of time, right? So that would form the bulk of your long-term investment goals and funds. So that is how we want our clients to look at us. Of course, many of us have inclinations to, you know, maybe investing in some tech companies, for example, frontier technologies, or maybe even ESG related, sustainable investing related money, right? But that is that could be part of a smaller allocation. Right, because that could be to some extent be a bit more active in nature. It could be something more for fun and more for fun conversations with our friends, right? But that is, yeah, that shouldn't form really the core part of our investing, because sectors come and go, companies come and go, and I think regardless whether you use endowments or not, right, passive investing should really form the core part of your investment holdings. That is the investment allocation that will form pay for the bills when you retire.
I think that's a good way to say it, because in a sense, you're talking about certain sectors have come and gone, and even if you do believe that certain sectors will take off, and if they do, they actually would make their way into passive. So you are making a wider bet on the conviction of capitalism and to some extent the human race keeping progressing, rather than would solar energy progress, for example. So yeah, personally I like that too. It's easier to sleep at night.
Yeah, it's a very comforting and very assuring way of investing to some extent.
Okay, let's move on. Next question is from Saturday Muse. How does it work? I'm assuming he or she is talking about robos. Does it really personalize for each individual?
I think the main part of personalization for many robos is around the risk profiling portion, right? So the risk profiling of you could be done through a risk questionnaire where we ask you how much losses are you willing to take. Some robos like to ask you about your investment experience, and that kind of question really help you understand what kind of market drawdown you are able to take, right? So for example, if you say that you are only willing to take a 20% loss, then perhaps having more bonds in your portfolio will make more sense for you, because end of the day, I think everybody wants a high return, right? Why want to earn 5% when you can earn 10%? Why earn 10% when you can earn 20%, right? So all of us want to get as high a return as possible. But when things like COVID-19 happen, when SARS happened, when global financial crisis happened, and the market tanks 20, 30, 40% within a matter of weeks, are we able to hold on to our investments or not?
Right. I think this is a very interesting point that is worth talking about. If you really boil it down to its essence, the reason why bonds is there is to help people stay the course and not freak out and act as a buffer, at least during your young age where you're investing, to stay the course. So the reason bonds are there is just to make it drop less so you don't freak out and leave the investment journey. So I always thought that was very interesting.
So there will be people who think that, hey, I want to get as high a return as possible. I want to maximize my returns because I'm going to put the money in for 30, 20 years anyway, right? But the fact of the matter is that the kind of volatility that you go through when you're 100% in equities versus when you're like maybe only 20% or 40% in equities is very different.
Okay, yeah, so I hope that answers the question, Saturday Muse. Now we go on to Aisha. What happens when a robo-advisor shuts down? What happens to your money investment? And I think we'll be bringing up a case study that happened back in March. One of the robo-advisors closed down. And do you have any insight into what happened?
Probably not specific to Smartly, but I guess maybe I can just answer from a perspective of a industry insider around how the MAS licensing works and how safe your money are, right? So for all the digital wealth platform or robo advisors, they are all managed by licensed by MAS. So they could be holding a financial advisor license or a capital market services license. So what that means is that for all of them, right, your investments and your money is being held in a custodian account, and that custodian account funds and the assets are legally separated from the robo-advisor's operational assets. So there's no mix of the company's operational funds as well as your investment assets as well as holdings, right? So you don't have to worry that your investments are being sold off to pay for someone's salary or paid for or someone's car or whatever, right? So there is very clear regulations and safeguards in place for that. But however, there are two different types of licensing involved. Smartly is holding on to a capital market services license. What this allows them to do is to be able to co-mingle the funds of different investors, right? So you can think of it as a put investment where maybe they have 100 different customers, right? But all of the investments of the 100 different customers are put together in a single custodian account. So what happens is that smartly investors have to liquidate their investments within a certain period of time. And of course, their monies are held safe and secure under the custodian account. But the entire arrangement is not great, especially during a period of market crisis, because there is a time gap between...
Back in March,
yeah,
right?
Exactly. Back in March, there's a time gap between selling your investment, getting your money, and reinvesting it into the financial markets again. So very likely that, you know, because of the time gap, you might be losing out on in terms of a very strong market recovery.
Because with MAS regulations, your money, you know, robots won't misappropriate your money. They are separated from the company's spending account. But actually, because of this nature of a co-mingled funds, you're actually forced to sell your investments if a robo-advisor closed down. And, you know, if it's a tough period in March where the markets are swinging up and down, left, right, center, with that lag period, you might actually lose money when you redeploy the money back into your investments, because the investment might have shot higher by the time you got your money back.
Yeah, so it's very important for us to invest in a platform that give us full faith and full ease of mind, right? Because end of the day, if you are even looking at robo-advisors, you want to have that peace of mind and you want to invest in a consistent manner without fearing that the platform second guessing what will happen next if the platform goes ceases operation. So
right. So how does endowers do it? It's like it's different.
Yes. So what we do is that every time you set up an account with us, a custodian account is actually created for you by UOB Kay Hian, right? So what happens is that your investments, your money are held in that custodian account, so that if any case that, you know, endowers chooses to cease operation, which is super unlikely, you will still have access to that account, and you can just liaise directly with Kay Hian.
Right, because it's already actually in a UOB Kay Hian in your own name, actually.
That's right.
How might someone actually figure out a robo-advisor has this kind of arrangement?
I think the best way to go about doing it is to ask them, right, or to get an explicit answer from them. So I think this it's worth the effort to understand a bit more about how you are keeping your money safe and secure on different platforms. So I think the most straightforward way is definitely to ask them and get a written answer,
right,
on it.
Worth doing, because if you do believe in long-term investing, you are in it for yourself. You want to make sure that even if a platform goes down, your investments are safe. So protect yourself.
Yeah, taking personal responsibility is actually is a good thing. So yeah, don't be afraid to ask. There's only so much we can rely on online reviews, blog posts. So definitely just reach out and ask if you are uncomfortable or if you have any burning questions.
Okay, so let's now talk about the next question from Esther Lee. What are some ways to invest passively rather than robo-advisors? So this is easy, because I think both of us do that. And I think first worth addressing, why do we do this? So, you know, for me, I'll start lah. Because in the end, doing it yourself definitely is the most low-cost way of investing passively. Definitely.
I think the preferred way by Yuan Duan is to do it through a low-cost brokerage. So one way of doing it is to perhaps use interactive brokers, right, and to invest it in a very consistent manner where you put in, say, $500 or $1,000 on a monthly basis into a UCITS ETF especially, right, because it's more tax efficient, low cost, and of course, most importantly, globally diversified with no over allocation or under allocation in specific sectors or countries. So that is also another way of passively investing. But when I started out in university, there are a lot more ways to invest passively now, right? So brokerages are working, providing a lot of different services. Banks are providing a lot of different services, and now you have the luxury of using robo advisors. But there are many multiple ways, and the kind of products that you get along the way, it's also different in some sense, right? So for example, you can get a regular savings plan with one of the local banks, right? But instruments behind it truly passive or not, when especially when you're just buying into a local index like the STI, right? So you are investing passively in a very consistent manner, right? But your underlying investments are not really diversified, and to some extent you can argue that that's not really true passive investing, right? So that is one way, right? A regular savings plan, but do take note of the kind of instruments you're buying into.
Yeah, you're right. I actually do use interactive brokers and do my own ETF purchases. How about you? Actually, personally, how do you passively invest?
I invest my CPF and SRS with endowers, right? So those are done on a really passive manner because SRS and CPF funds, we are able to pull it directly as long as we have the instructions, as long as we, the clients, give the instructions to the platform, right? So it's really very convenient. And for cash, I currently also use interactive brokers, and what I do is that I transfer automatically a small sum of money into that platform, and I will just go in and make a trade for it. So funnily, I think I spend a lot more time on interactive brokers than looking at my Endowus app, even though I'm an Endowus employee.
Yeah, because I mean, that's the point of it, isn't it? Like, it really just robo-advisors just run in the background, which is a good thing, I think.
Consider between the different choices, right? Find out what works best for you, and I think most importantly, understand what is the underlying investments that you are buying into, so that you know you are able to have that conviction to do it really consistently.
Okay, so now let's actually, this segues nicely to our next question by Ron Low. Given that UCITS ETFs are the most tax efficient, what ETFs do you personally own?
Yun Tan, why not you start off?
Okay, mine is very simple. Mine is just a single ETF called VWRA. It's by Vanguard, and it invests worldwide into mid and large cap companies around the world.
Maybe I'll just take a step back and not answer it directly. But I guess more importantly, we need to understand how to choose between the ETFs, because based on my understanding, VWRA only started 2 or 3 years ago, right? Before that, there are other more popular options out there, and those are slightly cheaper based on my understanding.
Right.
The way to look at it is when we choose our own ETFs is to, number one, look at cost, right? Cost in terms of the total expense ratio of the fund. And number two, it has to do with the liquidity of the ETF. So liquidity meaning to say how many ETFs are being traded, right? And that may in turn affect the bid-ask spread of the investment, right? And a big bid-ask spread basically means that you are going to pay a lot more for it, potentially pay a lot more for it compared to, an ETF that has a very small bid-ask spread. So for example, just to give a very simple example, if you were to go to, say, Carousell, and someone is putting, let's say, a laptop for $2,000, right? But you know that your own the price that you are willing to pay for it is maybe $800. So there is a very big mismatch between the expectation to sell and the expectation to buy. Right, so when there's a very big mismatch, both parties have to find a way to compromise, and that process of compromising actually is against us as consumer, because we are likely to pay a bigger premium compared to a ETF or a product that has a smaller bid-ask spread.
Yeah, you're right, and because VWRA is new, but there's also a certain amount of reasons that I picked it. Previously, I was using a very popular combo, which is something called IWDA and EIMI. So they are both a developed country ETF and an emerging markets ETF. So actually, VWRA, the one that I'm on now, is actually a combination of both. But you're right that actually the earlier combo of the two is cheaper. But honestly, I just wanted a more simple experience. Just go in, buy that one thing, come out. So I didn't mind paying a bit of a premium. So actually, if we could relate this to robos, You know, sometimes it really depends on some people. Are you willing to pay more for that convenience? So for me, yeah, I was willing to pay a little bit more for that convenience of just buying that one ticker. It's a bit more advanced to it because, in a sense, when you buy IWDA and EIMI, there's a certain weightage you need to put between the two. And it changes every year and it updates. So like for example, IWDA, which is developed markets, should be a higher percentage than emerging markets. You should put more money into it. And every year, it could change that percentage. And I did not want to track that. So if I buy VWRA, it would be done automatically for me. So actually, that's another big reason why I went in. I don't know whether that was too difficult to follow, but that was why.
Yeah, I guess that's really where robo-advisors may help you better in terms of your investment strategy and the execution of it, right? So we don't have to do it ourselves because it's so simple for, you know, a platform to calculate how much more to buy of a certain fund, how much less to buy of a certain fund, so that you keep to your same investment goals, right? So for example, using Yuanduan's investment strategy. So instead of doing, let's say, 80% IWDA, 20% EIMI all the time, right? What the robo-advisors do is to take into account the market movement and help you invest in a way so that in the end, your portfolio will end up 80% IWDA, 20% EIMI on a consistent basis. So because of the way the markets move, sometimes IWDA will do better, sometimes EIMI will do a bit better. So that ratio of the split between those two funds will fluctuate, right? But for the robo-advisor, every time there is a period of time where you know, there is new money coming in, so we can help you automatically rebalance so that you know you don't have to go and take out your calculator, open your Excel spreadsheet and do the calculation yourself. So it's really meant for you to have a very convenient experience.
Actually, yeah, that's on one level, which you're absolutely right. But I think actually I was talking about another level is actually on the index level.
Ah, okay.
But yeah, that gets a bit too complicated. That one's like depends on the MSCI or the FTSE. How do they actually weigh between the different countries? But let's not go into that. That could be a bit abstract. Mm. Okay. Maybe then we can go on to the next question. This question is from Queenie XYZ. Any book or platform to recommend for someone who practically does not know anything?
Mm.
So TSS and Endowus Block first.
Oh yeah, so that, yeah, do check out TSS first because they have a lot of interesting content and very graphics driven things, right? So yeah, it's really interesting and I think some of it is really very well portrayed. Do check out all TS, The Simple Sum, or even Endowus Insights, right? But if you were to look at specifically at books, I would recommend A Random Walk Down Wall Street, The Time-Tested Strategy for Successful Investing. So it's actually written by a Princeton economist, and I think it's helpful for me because it really brings up some of the common investment, active investment strategies and why it's difficult for us as individuals to execute it out on a consistent manner, right? When it comes to things like fundamental analysis, when it comes to things like technical analysis, this kind of concepts, why does it not really work out as well as people put it across? It really explains it very well, right? And I think many of the concepts that are espoused within that book is really around investing long term, being diversified, focusing on cost, right? Things that are really within our control as a retail investor at the very onset of our investment. Yeah, so I think it not just teaches you what to do, it also brings a case of what not to do. What about you, Yuanduan? Mm. What's your favorite investment book for someone new?
I would recommend a book called Rich by Retirement by Joshua Gersh. It's actually an Australian dude who's on Hardware Zone. He has his own thread called Shiny, and his handle is Shiny Things. So why do I recommend this? It actually gives very prescriptive advice to a beginner on how do you approach not just investing, but also stuff like insurance, even SRS account, etc., etc. And it's really a very short read, I believe, like 30 pages or so. For if you are really, you know, don't know where to start, that really points you in a very good direction, I think. So I really would highly recommend it. It's an ebook that someone can buy. It's quite cheap online. Let's now we go on to the last question by Ming T Chan. Is it okay to just be a passive investor?
Probably we'll give our very specific and to some extent hardcore views around that. I think it's actually very okay to just be a passive investor, and the reason why I say so is that the fact that you are just a passive investor doesn't mean that it is very easy to be a passive investor, right? The concept of passive investing is very simple, very intuitive. It's very easy for us to have conviction on it, and it's to a very large extent, these concepts are validated by research. So it's simple to do it, but it's actually very difficult to stay passively invested for us, right?
Definitely.
Right. To come up with very simple excuses like, oh, I wait for the market to stabilize before I go in again, right? Or the market seems to be too volatile. Time to pull out some money.
Things are overvalued, time to get out.
Exactly. And that is not just what, you know, people like Yuan Duan and I say. It's what economists like to say when they make statements in the newspaper, right? There are journalists who like to make this kind of statement. And to some extent, it sounds very sensible and it sounds very wise, but that is a low-key way of timing the market or being active in the market. So I think my recommendation to Ming T Chan is that even though passive investing is very simple, right, but it really takes a lot of fortitude and discipline to stay passive in the way that you invest. So it's okay. It's not just okay to be a passive investor. It's an achievement. It's an achievement to be a passive investor. Yeah.
Definitely. It's hard. You know, I think there's something I want to say is that I think you and me, we have talked to people outside, actually try to tell them, you know, you should passively invest. You know, read this book. I go around like distributing materials and like, you know, really, I think this is a great way to start even for your first and last investment style that you might. And sometimes out of the 100, maybe not 100, that's exaggerating, maybe like 20 people I talk to, maybe one or two people start. But so far, a lot of them stray off. You know, especially once they start opening an app, like Interactive Broker, they start looking at the price movements, you know, they start to look at, or they see the news and the headlines and fear, and they actually, within like not even a year, they have straight off the course. So it's really not easy. And I think you and me, we have, you know, because we have this conviction based on things that we have read and historical data. So it's not easy. It's not easy to really have conviction. And I think some parts of it come with education.
Exactly. Yeah. So I totally agree on the education part, and I don't think it necessarily has to be a black and white thing, right? So back to Ming T Chan's point, if you really want to have a small part of your investment into active investing, right, just to have a feel of what it means to you, right, just to have a feel of like reading up, doing your own research, spending some time understanding how the markets work, I think it can be a very wise decision as well, as long as you keep within certain boundaries that you're comfortable with, right? Then maybe you want to allocate a small portion to actively invest as part of your satellite portfolio, for example, right? So that you have a feel of the market, you understand better what works best for you. So it won't just be a solution that, you know, you are just following blindly what other people are doing, but really a process that you are comfortable with yourself, because end of the day, conviction, end of the day, discipline is something that is nurtured rather than something that is, you know, you copy and paste from a textbook.
I think for me, my point is to Ming T is like, you know, I think we mentioned before, passive investing as your core base of your portfolio is a good idea. Keeps you on track. And, you know, we are all human. You know, buy 4D, buy Toto. Gambling can be fun. But no, I think we just do it and recognize that if we are gambling, it is gambling. And if we are losing that money, we are going to be okay with it. As such, let's put a very small fixed portion of that into that. Let's say you are passively investing 90% and 10% is your gambling fund. So, you know, if that 10% blows up, you're like, that
yeah,
was
but I wouldn't then. Use the word gambling, but I really hope that you don't treat it as gambling, right? Because end of the day, that 10% of money could be really hard-earned, hard-saved money.
Of course.
So if you want to do course. It, be accountable to yourself. So I mean, it really again, that part on accountability can vary very widely across between individuals. Some people think that they need to put in like 4 or 5 hours of work to understand a stock, then okay, then they are being accountable to themselves in that sense, if you they were to really put in that work, right? But if you think that being accountable to yourself means going on to Reddit, Wall Street Bets, and you know, choosing the best, the most upvoted comment and investing based on it, then I would probably think that that's not a very accountable way of doing your active investing. So it really depends, varies between individuals. So just do go through that process, understand yourself better, and you know, invest in a way that's that you're comfortable with.
I think that's a good wrap up question. You know, I think we also address some of the so-called, I wouldn't say weaknesses, but one of the challenges of passive investing is really not as easy as it looks. I think we can actually wrap up with, you know, some takeaways that Xingxi, you want to reinforce to our listeners today.
So I think Saturday News asked a very good question. So how do I choose between robo-advisors? What should I do? What am I looking out for when I'm passively investing? I think the most important thing for many of listeners or even viewers or subscribers of Endowus, I think they want to have a convenience solution, a peace of mind when they invest, right? So, you know, being clear about what you want in your investment, in the advisor that you choose, the robo-advisor that you choose, or the investment strategy that you have is very important, because there will be a lot of conflicting and confusing content out there. And of course, the next thing is not just knowing what you want, but also how much time and effort you want to put into it, right? Potentially, a robo-advisor can help you in terms of the time and effort you need to look at it, because all of the decisions are pretty much set for you after you are done with the onboarding process, or after you have set all the goals up, right? So in that sense, you are minimizing your chance of making mistakes. So that is one key takeaway, right? The second takeaway is that to really understand what passive investing mean for you. So are you investing in just ETFs and you have no idea how they invest the ETFs? Then that is also an issue, right? Understand what passive investing in terms of asset allocation, in terms of being consistently invested in the market means, and execute on it. I think that's very important as well. And I think the last part is really to have a plan and to get started, right? So it's always nice to we feel good and there's some form of comfort when we feel that, hey, I've read up on something, okay, I feel empowered about it, but at the end of the day, we may not act on it. Get started, have a very clear plan how you want to invest, right? And then stick to it, because that's the only way. The market is very volatile. It's gonna be simple, but it's not going to be easy for you to execute. So have those in mind, and I think pretty much you are set for your investment goals.
If to recap, what do you want from your investment experience? Understand what true passive investing is, and have a plan you can execute. So maybe we can end on that, Xingxi, and maybe I'll ask you a question. What is your investment goal? Your personal investment goal. Do you have one?
It's a very good It's actually a very abstract thing that I think many people struggle to answer. So for me, I'm investing for retirement, but I would say that I invest in a way so that I can focus on my career, have a peace of mind, and potentially retire earlier. So, yeah, but I think that's my investment goal.
Same here. So for me, my investment goal is a somewhat earlier retirement at 55. So I have actually a specific sum in mind and I'm working towards it. So yeah, that's a nice note to end on, and we can retire and hopefully we can move retire slightly earlier.
No, I'd rather not use the word retire, but maybe just be so financially secure that we can take on jobs, gigs, or anything that
financial freedom. The more exciting.
Exactly. Retire is very the word just makes us envision older people.
I'm on a quest to change it. But I understand what you mean. Like for me, it's like it could be, you know, really taking it slower, or really pursuing a passion in, you know, a certain field that financially may not be rewarding, etc. So yeah, it's, you know, just opening up opportunities, and I think both of us are aligned in that regard. I think yeah, that's the end. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you so much, Yuan Duan, for having me on, and really do check us out on endowus.com. We have a lot of interesting content on Endowus Insights, and as well as on our YouTube channel.
Hey all, that's a wrap, and we hope it was useful. But we have to disclaim that everything we discussed today does not constitute financial advice. This means do your reading, fully understand what you're getting yourself into before making any investment decisions. Next week, we'll be covering everybody's favorite secondary school friends topic, insurance.